into three main collections. We have the books, the archives, and the artifacts. And the materials in each collection range in time period from the very old to the modern, from fabric to microfiche to metals to documents. While material is separated into these various collections, their stories are all interwoven into one large web. For a researcher, this is a fascinating way to get the full story to a single question. As such, one can expect to find treasures every time they approach our stacks. One example is when I was assisting a patron with information concerning Prince Hall. A brother had come in and asked for a biography of Prince Hall, the man who was associated with the start of African-American Freemasonry. Using our catalog, I wandered to the back and found a standard biography, Prince Hall, Life and Legacy by Charles H. Wesley. Looking for some more possible resources, I pulled out a sleek binder and found a document that was much more intriguing. Dated 1792, the small pamphlet was entitled Charge Delivered to the Brethren of the African Lodge on the 25th of June, 1792, at the Hall of Brother William Smith in Charleston by the Right Worshipful Master, Prince Hall, printed at the request of the Lodge. This is also an original. So,
what year is it?
1792. As you can imagine, this piqued my interest and immediately took it out for the brother to see. He was ecstatic, and in turn, so was I. What drew me to this document, which ended up being a 13-page pamphlet, was its reflections on being a black man after the American Revolutionary War, and the social climate of the time that was preventing black men from receiving the rights that were just fought for. In the pamphlet, he indicates that he will focus on reviewing the basic ideals of what makes a good Freemason. But Prince Hall's address of racial prejudices and suspicions against black men underline a large part of the document. As he notes on the first two pages, again, we must be good subjects to the laws of the land in which we dwell, giving homage to our lawful governors and magistrates, giving honor to whom honor is due, and that we have no hand in any plots or conspiracies or rebellion or side of assist in them. For when we consider the bloodshed, the devastation of towns and cities that hath been done by them, what heart can be so hard as not to pity those, our different brethren, and keep at the greatest distance from them? However just it may be on the side of the oppressed, yet it doth not in the least, or rather ought not, abate that love and fellow feeling which we ought to have for our brother fellow men. By starting the document in this manner, before going into detail about his original point, is telling about the historical time period. It seems to serve as a disclaimer, stating that there is nothing inherently malicious with black men congregating in one area. Ironically, after a war that was fought to free the oppressed from unjust rule, Prince Hall is aware that injustices were not lifted for all individuals within America. However, even though he understands that he and his brethren are part of the oppressed, to violently react is also not the right way. Instead, he urges for peaceful objection, aligning himself with Masonic ideals. At the end of this pamphlet, though, he becomes more blatant concerning these injustices that are facing black men during this time. In the last pages, he says, query, whether at that day, when there was an African church, and perhaps the largest Christian church on earth, whether there was no African of that order, or whether if they were all whites, they would refuse to accept them as their fellow Christians and brother Masons, or whether there were any so weak, or rather so foolish as to say, because they were blacks, that would make their lodge or army too common or too cheap. Sure, this was not our conduct in the late war, for when they marched shoulder to shoulder, brother soldier and brother soldier, to the field of battle, let who will answer that he that despises a black man for the sake of that color reproaches his maker and has resented it. Here, Prince Hall clearly condemns the prejudices and racism that was being directed to black men, barring them from participating in organizations that were meant for the greater good. Having read this pamphlet, it very much opened my eyes to the society that was cultivated post-American Revolutionary War. From my days in school, I remember studying the Revolutionary War, then the writing of the Constitution, and then straight into the War of 1812. Little was brought up about the sociological implications that had occurred post-war. As I often tell patrons, what I find interesting about this collection is that it provides various different perspectives on history that are normally not known among mainstream history textbooks. So this brings up the question, who was Prince Hall? To look up this information, I first turned to our subject folders, which we have here. There are various accounts of his life before he became a Freemason. The New Mexico Freemason states that he was born as a slave in 1735 in the West Indies, and eventually sold to William Hall, a real estate broker and leather worker in Boston. According to this article, he eventually gained his freedom at 40 and supported himself as a laborer and leather dresser. A widely circulated account stems from William H. Grimshaw's 1903 Official History of Freemasonry Among the Colored People in North America. In our book collection, we have a first edition copy of this text. He indicates that Prince Hall was born a freeman in 1748 in Barbados, and that he was the child of Thomas Prince Hall and a free colored woman of French extraction. The book states that he worked his passage into Boston as a leather worker. Eventually acquiring real estate, he was qualified to vote and became a minister in the African Methodist Episcopal Church with a charge in Cambridge. Grimshaw's account is nowadays considered to be a slight exaggeration, and to verge on the side of being slightly untrue. However, as indicated by the first book that started this whole search, Grimshaw's account helped to revitalize interest in the history of Prince Hall, who had previously been another forgotten figure in history. What is considered fact is that Prince Hall and 14 other men were initiated into Lodge No. 441, a military lodge that was working under the Grand Lodge of England, Grand Lodge of Ireland, which was attached to the 38th Regiment of Foot, British Army at Boston Harbor on March 6, 1775. So going into, delving into our museum collection. Let's see. So this is a photostat negative of the muster of Lodge number 441 of the military lodge that was associated. And as you can see, listed right over there is John Batt. And John Batt was the master of Lodge number 441. So. The other 14 free black men were Cyrus Johnbus, Boyston Slinger, Prince Reese, John Canton, Peter Freeman, Benjamin Tiber, Duff Beauform, Thomas Sanderson, Prince Raiden, Cato Sveen, Boston Smith, Peter Bess, Fordin Howard, and Richard Tiley. After Lodge number 441 left, it granted Prince Hall and the 14 men to meet under dispensation as African Lodge number 1, so they could participate in the procession on St. John's Day and bury their dead as a lodge. However, they were not given dispensation to give out degrees or to participate in Masonic work. As African Lodge No. 1, while unable to do these types of activities, there is still evidence that they had continued to meet as a group. On March 2, 1784, Prince Hall petitioned to the Grand Lodge of England through William Moody of Brotherly Love Lodge 55 for a warrant. This was granted on September 29, 1784, and they were now to be known as African Lodge number 459. Here we have a photo of the original charter. So the original charter is currently right now in Massachusetts in a vault. So most people usually don't get a chance to see the original. But this is a photo that we have of the original charter itself. There's that. And then we have one more version of the charter, because as you could probably tell, that was slightly difficult to read. Just slightly, only. We do have a readable version over here. So. the duplicate copy. And the charter indicates that Prince Hall would be its master, Boston Smith as senior warden, and Thomas Sanderson as junior warden. The charter was finally delivered to African Lodge No. 459 in 1787 by John Hancock's brother-in-law. For anyone that doubts the respectability of Prince Hall's character, it should be of note that Prince Hall had business relations with John Hancock himself, as indicated by these bills from John Hancock to Prince Hall. These are photostats that are actually from John Hancock's papers that are currently located in Massachusetts Historical Society. So you can see it says John Hancock, Prince Hall, and he paid all his bills. So that's a good thing. Respectable businessman. And then this is the back that indicates Prince Hall's bill. This is the notation, as well as the date itself. In 1792, the lodge was renumbered to 370, but it is generally believed by many scholars that the lodge was not informed of this change. According to Grimshaw, Prince Hall was eventually appointed provincial grand master in 1791 by the Prince of Wales. While this has been largely questioned by many scholars, Wesley notes that there is the slightest possibility, but confirmation shall remain unclear for the time being. However, what has been approved by scholars is that he did indeed, acting as a mother lodge, establish two new lodges, which were African Lodge number 459, which we have a photograph of an 1814 apron from that lodge. So this is from 1814, not the photograph, the apron. as well as Hiram Lodge number 3 in Rhode Island in 1797. While master of African Lodge, Prince Hall continued to fight for racial equality, as indicated in another charge he gave in 1797. And the charge is right over here. So this itself is not an original from 1797, but it does contain all the same content. And in this charge, he details insults and racial aggression that is faced in Boston and in America in general. Rather than using aggression, he says that to fight said injustices, there's a need for sympathy and patience. As he notes, "My brethren, let us not be cast down under these and many other abuses we at present labor under. The darkest is before the break of day." He reiterates this philosophy by stating that, even if oppressed, there needs to be sympathy for all, for the distressed brethren of the human race in their troubles. On December 4th, 1807, Prince Hall passed, and he was succeeded by Nero Prince. Transitioning into a mother lodge, there are various accounts of when African Lodge 459 transformed into African Grand Lodge. Some say in 1791, with Prince Hall as Grand Master. Others believe the start was in 1827, after African Lodge number 459 in Boston declared independence from England, or even as late as 1847, with the introduction of National Grand Lodge. Another version, which is supported by the most worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Massachusetts, states that it was created in 1808, when African Lodge number 459 and the two lodges it chartered convened and agreed to organize themselves as such. While various resources utilize different dates, soon after, African Grand Lodge would have its name changed to Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Massachusetts in honor of their late leader. Over the years, there have been many discussions regarding the legitimacy of Black Freemasonry. The allegations are far out and wide and would be considered controversial and outlandish in our current times. During my research, the two most common arguments against legitimacy were based on African Lodge 459's relationship with England, which has been one of controversy. For instance, It is known that African Grand Lodge number 459 was dropped from the roll of the Grand Lodge of England in 1813, which was reiterated in this letter to Right Worshipful Edward R. Carman in 1960. While many cited this as a discredit, the authors from Out of the Shadows, which I highly recommend this book, it's a great book, indicate that in all honesty, the lodge was probably never notified that had been dropped from the rolls. In fact, 55 other American lodges were dropped as well, making many accepted Grand Lodges actually unrecognized from the United Grand Lodge of England from the time of their declaration of Masonic independence until the late 1840s and a little bit after. Another important date is when African Lodge number 459 declared independence from England in 1827, as listed in the Boston Daily Advertiser. So that's when African Lodge number 459 officially declared themselves as no longer working under the Grand Lodge of England. As this pamphlet shows, which was sent out by what is known as the Masonic Research Associates, but many believe is actually supposed to have been by Edward Cusick. This Declaration of Independence was used as a way to discredit African Lodge 459 and its eventual transition into a mother lodge. As they claimed independence, they also claimed that they were creating their own Grand Lodge, African Grand Lodge number 1. According to this pamphlet, the objection was that there was already a Grand Lodge of Massachusetts in place. However, as many advocates have noted, African Lodge number 459 was acting in the same manner that the American provincial Grand Lodges had done, and establishing itself as a mother lodge and declaring independence. And in many other countries, it was common to have multiple Grand Lodges. In addition, as Out of the Shadow notes, when the two existing Grand Lodges in Massachusetts consolidated in 1792, two lodges were not invited, St. Andrew's and African Lodge. The former was later invited in 1809, but the latter was never extended an invitation. These acts reflect what M.R. Delaney said in 1853. It's called The Origins and Objects of Ancient Freemasonry, Its Introduction into the United States, and Legitimacy Among Colored Men, from 1803. This also, too, is an original. So, and he says, it was a matter of choice, now wishing, for reasons better known to themselves, to be subordinate to the Grand Lodge of England. While with us, it was forced upon our fathers by necessity, they having applied to different Grand Lodges at different times in different states for warrants to work under them, and as often spurned and rejected. However, what is important to note is that even with these setbacks, Prince Hall Masonry was still able to flourish into the organization it is today and has always had supporters for its legitimacy. Going back to M.R. Delaney, he spends a large portion of his treatise proving legitimacy by stating the racial tensions that were preventing black men from entering lodges and using history to indicate that black men are men of character in opposition to the prevailing social objection. Other notable mentions include Albert Pike, who even though he himself was not a major advocate for Prince Hall Masonry, did use his pen to acknowledge and support the legitimacy of African Lodge number 459 and its transition into a mother lodge. Grand Master William H. Upton of the Grand Lodge of Washington State garnered the first recognition of Prince Hall Freemasonry in 1898 in Washington. Though short-lived due to its controversy, he continued to fight for its legitimacy for the rest of his life. Melvin M. Johnson convinced the Grand Lodge of Massachusetts that the most worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Massachusetts was legitimate in 1947. And Alan E. Roberts was a major writer in the late 20th century who researched Prince Hall and brought it to mainstream attention, being one of the most widely publicized Masonic authors to write about its legitimacy directed to accepted Grand Lodges. In New York, there has always been a flourishing of Prince Hall Masons and pride in its organization, as seen by the number of operating lodges and various number of invitations, events, and programs that were and are still being held today, as seen in this ephemera. So, Edward Cusick, back in the day, he did have a list. So there were about In 1952, there were already 54 Prince Hall lodges that were operating within the state of New York. And then, some people here might know, Boyer Lodge, Lodge number one. And so these are for more modern, so for instance, as you can tell, that's more of a modern photograph, not an older one. But we, for instance, still have ephemera. So for example, some communications, and these date back. And what was most interesting when looking through these files was that Prince Hall Masons have always been, had a large participation in public events. And we actually have photographs from when Prince Hall Masons took part in relaying the cornerstone that was in memory of Frederick Douglass in Highland Park. So let me show you these photographs. So as you can see, these are much older. Yes, so this was specifically from 1941. Down the street. For anyone who's interested in these, you can take a closer look after the lecture. Prince Hall Masons were active in the civil rights movement, such as their holding of Freedom Now rallies and talks with NAACP chiefs, of which we have notices for. Freedom Now rallies. As you can see, they say, please post. So not traditional email, as we do nowadays. As well as they're meeting with the NAACP chief. We have the newspaper clipping. In the papers of W. David H. Goldsmith, who was a master of Zealous Lodge 115 in the 1960s, we found a speech, which he gave while he was master. And when he gave this, it was aligning himself in recognition with Prince Hall Masons and expounding on their desire for recognition. As he states, and as a Mason, I feel the only true solution lies in cultivating everywhere the spirit of brotherhood, of feeling and understanding between man and man. And we must cultivate willingness to treat every man as a man, regardless of color. In New York Law Journal on January 30th, 1962, an article was published. And this article was concerning a trial held between the most worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge in New York versus another New York African-American Grand Lodge. The original trial, these were the notices that were part of the article itself. Illustrious George E. Bushnell, as the Supreme Grand Commander, ancient accepted Scottish Rite, Northern Masonic Jurisdiction, stated under oath that the Supreme Council of the Northern Masonic Jurisdiction recognized Prince Hall Masons, and that this had always been the case. While traditionally, the Supreme Council has supported cooperation and the legality of Prince Hall Masons since the early 1900s, it should be noted that Bushnell, in his position of power, took a risk to advocate for what he and the Supreme Council thought was right, as he was subsequently chastised as such in this letter, and questioned for his statement. Fortunately, there is a positive resolution to all of this. In New York, the Committee on Unity was established in 1988 to start discussions about the relationship between the Grand Lodge of New York and the Brethren of the Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodges, with Right Worshipful Daniel M. Semmel, Judge Advocate, as chairman. In 1993, Brother Semmel became the first Grand Representative of the Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of New York, near the Grand Lodge of New York. After a number of years, in 2001, as these proceedings show, and we have more than our fair share behind me, the proceedings indicate that Most Worshipful Carl J. Smith and Most Worshipful Wilburn E. Gaither, the Grand Master of Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of New York, agreed to support mutual recognition of each other, which was immortalized in a historic meeting on June 8, 2001 between Masada Lodge 115 and Hudson River Lodge 309. And as you can expect, we do have the newspaper article, which we have here. So this is 2011, due to his many years of effort in obtaining mutual recognition between the Grand Lodge of New York and the Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of New York, Most Worshipful Daniel M. Semmel was elected an honorary past Grand Master of the Most Worshipful Prince Hall Grand Lodge of New York. In the aforementioned charge from 1797, Prince Hall told his brethren, "Live and act as Masons, that you may die as Masons. Let those despisers see, although many of us cannot read, yet by our searches and researches into men and things, we have supplied that defect. And if they will let us, we shall call ourselves a chartered lodge of just and lawful Masons. Give the right hand of affection and fellowship to whom it justly belongs. Let their color and complexion be what it will. Let their nation be what it may, for they are our brethren." With such mutual recognition, the Grand Lodge of New York and Most Worshipful Prince Hall Masons of New York are able to operate parallel to one another in harmony and friendship, fulfilling Prince Hall's hope for legitimacy, acceptance, and union as a brethren. Thank you.